You all, a very good morning to all the participants. Behalf of Kappagonego College of Engineering and Technology, Department of Biotechnology, we are organizing this 1 week online course on nanobiotechnology and its applications. Okay, first day we are going to see about the nanobiotechnology. Under that, how the nanoparticles are classified, what are their properties, and what are the methods are there to synthesize the nanoparticles. Okay, let's see the course. Okay, what is nanoscience? Nanoscience is the study of phenomena and manipulation of materials at atomic, molecular, and macromolecular scales, where the properties differ significantly from those materials at larger scale. Nothing but the nanoparticles are differ from those particles in a macro size, that is nano size. How the particles make a difference from the same material at a macro size and the nano size. That is the field of science, that is a nanoscience. Okay, and next is what is about nanotechnology. Nanotechnology is the design, characterization, production, and application of structures, devices, and systems by controlling shape and size at nanometer scale. The technology is used to design, characterize, production, nothing but synthesis, and its application and application. This is about the nanotechnology. By controlling each size and shape, particle size and shape in a nanometer scale. Okay, next, what is about nanobiotechnology? It's a combination of classical microtechnology with a molecular biological approach. Biotechnology uses the knowledge and the techniques of biology to manipulate molecular, genetic, and cellular process to develop products and services, and is used in diverse fields from medicine to agriculture. So about nanobiotechnology, you are going to manipulate the old biological resources in the form of devices or labeling materials for various applications, that is from medicine to agriculture. Okay. So what are nanomaterials? The nanomaterials or materials, this is having a unique and novel property due to its nanoscale size. Okay, fundamentally it is having a different properties of those materials at a bulk in size. Okay, so a nanomaterials or nanostructured materials is defined as solid material characterized at one dimension nanometer range. So based on the dimension, the nanomaterials are of different types, that is one dimensional materials, two dimensional materials, three dimensional materials, and zero dimensional materials. So first of all, we have to know what is nanoparticles and its size. Nanoparticles are the particles of size between the range of 1 nanometer to 100 nanometer in size. Okay, so first we will take a standard measurement of 1 meter. Okay, by multiplication of 1000 with this 1 meter, you will be getting a 1 kilometer. By dividing of 1000 with this 1 meter, you will be getting a 1 millimeter. Okay, so by dividing of this 1 millimeter with 1000, you will be getting a 1 micrometer. By dividing of this 1 micrometer with 1000, you will be getting a 1 meter. So, the third division of 1000 is getting 1 meter. At the third division of 1000, you are getting this 1 nanometer size, that is billionth of a meter is a nanometer, and thousands of the meter is a micrometer. So compared to the microorganism, these nanomaterials are very small in size. So we can use this nanoparticles for various antimicrobial resistant materials and also to treat various viral diseases and gene therapies. So it is having a lot of biological applications. So there are different types of nanomaterials are there: particles, capsules, fibers, wires, filaments, tubes, rings, belts, dots and fluidics. So how this nanomaterials is having the properties, lot of properties like electrical, optical, electronic, mechanical, biological, due to the two principal factors, that is increased relative surface area, means it is due to its small size, it is having a large surface area to volume ratio. So according to the volume, it is in small in size, okay, but it is having a large surface area. Due to of its small surface area, it is having a major biological applications like coating of antibodies, proteins, antigens, biomolecules for the target drug delivery. Okay, and the next principal factor is that quantum confinement effect. So what is quantum confinement effect? That is wrapping a particles or restrict their motion in a particular position. That is in the quantum confinement. Nothing but let's take an example. When you switch on the power, the fan gets rotates. How fast the current is reaching the fan to make to rotate? So how the current is passing? That is a movement of electron from one place to the target place. That is making the neighboring electrons to vibrate and make the current to pass reach the fan. Then how fast this electron is moving? Okay, that is happening in a macro materials. So in case of nanomaterials, it happening due to of this quantum confinement, your nanoparticle is going to be confined in a any dimension, on a at least a one dimension. So based on the dimension, this quantum confinement is going to be differ. So let's see the properties of materials based on that two principal factors. That is due to the larger surface area when compared to the materials, it is having large surface area, those materials are in a larger form. Okay. And next, due to its small size, it is mostly having a chemically reactive in nature. So it is able to cross all the barriers, even blood-brain barriers, plasma membranes, placenta membranes to deliver your drugs. So it can be utilized in a brain disorders to treat various diseases. Next is a quantum confinement. It's a dominant behavior factor in case of nanoscale materials. Due to of that two principal factors, it is having a major optical properties. Because of this optical properties, different nanoparticle size exhibits different wavelength of colors. So based on its size, the nanoparticles may exhibit a different colors. See, 100 silver nanoparticles is showing a reddish brown, and in case of gold it is giving a light brown, and in case of gold in 50 nanometer it's showing it is a green. In 120 sphere of nanometer sphere of silver nanometer, it is showing a sandal-like color. In case of 80 nanometer silver, it is showing a lightish blue. And in case of 40, it is showing a dark blue color. Actually, based on the size, the nanoparticles may exhibit a different colors. This is a major optical property of the nanomaterials. That is, a frame shift is happening due to of its plasma resonance band. Okay, so these are the images of the those nanoparticles, and it exhibits a increased strength and tensile property and magnetic property, optical property, color changes with size. Okay, and these are the nanoscale effects on the properties, catalytic, this is a blood, catalytic efficiency improves. And in case of electrical, it is exhibits increased electrical conductivity. And in case of magnetic, it is a magnetic corrosivity. And mechanically, it is shows the improved hardness and toughness of materials, superplasticity and ductility property. In case of optical, it exhibits optical absorption fluorescent property, can be utilized in a cancer therapy. For bioimaging application, in biological, it is an increased permeability through the biological barriers. Okay, let's see the what is the difference between a microstructure and a nanostructure. In case of physics, the microstructure materials are semi-classical. In case of nanostructure, it is a quantum mechanical in nature. As we all know, the electron exhibits a both particle and wavelet nature, but the particle-like nature can be seen only with the microstructure. We can see the wavelet structure of the electron in a nanostructure. Okay, and surfaces to volume ratio. See, microstructures are very small compared to the volume, that is ratio is small. And in case of nanostructure, the surface is having very large in compared to the volume. Okay. And the classification of nanomaterials. Based on the nanomaterial particles nature, it differs of four types: capsules, fibers, wires and fluorescence. Base of tubes, it means goes to differ springs, belts, quantum dots and fluidics. Okay, let's see the classification of nanomaterials based on dimension. It is of zero dimension. At already I say that a quantum effect. Okay, zero dimension, one dimension, two dimension and three dimension materials. Okay. Let's see what is happening in one dimension, zero dimension and two dimension. In case of zero dimension, the nanoscale material will have confined of three dimension in at a single point. At a single point, it is going to confine all the dimensions, that is zero dimension. For example, it is a nano dots. Okay, and in case of one dimension, it has only one parameter, either length, breadth, height. Either it is length or breadth or height. Okay, for example, thin surface coatings. In case of two dimension, nanoscale material will have only length or breadth. That is nanowires, tubes. In case of three dimension, it has all the parameters, length, breadth and height. That is nanoparticles example. Okay. So, how the quantum confinement is going to differ of the three this dimensional materials? Okay, in case of three dimensional material, the energy flowing is continuous in manner. But in case of two dimension, one dimension materials, the energy flowing is semi-continuous in manner. For zero dimension, it is in the energy level is in a discrete energy level. That is free energy, Fermi energy level, Fermi level energy. That is, it is having a very sharp energy. So due to of this effect of discrete energy flowing, this quantum dots are required to code the antibodies to deliver a antibodies or a genes to a target place in a cancer therapy. Okay, next we go to the second part of the first day class, that is the synthesis of nanomaterials. It's a vast subject of the nanotechnology, that is the synthesis of nanomaterials. And it has two approaches, that is top bottom and bottom up approach. The top bottom approach is nothing but a breaking down process. It looks like a breaking down process. That is the conversion of macro size to nano size, decreasing size. It can be seen only with the physical methods. In case of bottom-up approach, the minute particles are assembled together or joined together, bind together, aggregate together to form a nanostructures. It is like a building-up process. It can majorly seen both the chemical and biological methods. Okay, and based on this two approach, there are three different methods are there to synthesize the nanomaterials. That is physical, chemical and biological methods. And the physical methods, those are the different techniques are there to synthesize the nanomaterials. மெக்கானிக்கல் மில்லிங், வேப்பட பொசிஷன், எபிடாக்சியல் மெத்தட், மேக்னட்ரான் ஸ்பட்டரிங், லித்தோகிராஃபி, மைக்ரோ கான்டாக்ட் பிரிண்டிங், எச்சிங், இனர்ட் கேஸ் கண்டென்சேஷன், லேசர் அப்ளேஷன், வேப்பரைசேஷன். பட் இன் கேஸ் ஆஃப் கெமிக்கல்ஸ் மெத்தட் ஆஃப் சிந்தசிசிங், இட் இஸ் ஹேவிங் சால்ட் ஜெல் மெத்தட், சால்வர் தெர்மல், ஹைட்ரோ தெர்மல், பிரிசிபிடேஷன், ஸ்ப்ரே பைரோலைசிஸ், எலக்ட்ரோ ஸ்ப்ரேயிங், ஸ்பின் கோட்டிங், செல்ஃப் அசம்பிளி, மைக்ரோ எமல்ஷன், பாலிமரைசேஷன். And in the biological method, the nanoparticles are used to synthesize the using plant extract enzymes, microorganisms, biological waste, proteins. Okay, so let's see one by one of the different methods of synthesizing the nanomaterials. Okay, so first technique is the mechanical milling. It is coming under the physical method of nanomaterial synthesis. Mechanical milling is nothing but the grinding of the desired material or metal salt component with the help of milling balls, which is loaded into the mechanical milling vials. See, this is a vial. Inside the vial, you are going to load the mechanical balls, nothing but metal balls and a metal powder, salt powder, which is a desired material you need to synthesize. That one has need to load, and impellers and agitator is going to mix to perform the centripetal force inside the vial by making these balls to rotate, to pinch over the walls of the vessel and pinch over the salt powder to reduce the size into the nanoscale size. So nothing but grinding method, same like what we are doing to make a rice flour, same like that. It is going to reduce the size of the metal, macro size to nano size is going to happen with the help of this metal balls. Now here the principle of this technique, it is a friction force is going to happen between the balls and the powder towards the walls of the vials. So the equipments available for this mechanical milling is planetary mills and atrator mill, which those two equipments is having a more friction towards the synthesis of materials, nanomaterials. There is availability of this mills from lab scale to industrial mills. So these are the pics which is showing that atrator mill and the planetary mill, which is available in the industries to make a nanoparticles for various coating purpose. And next method is the vaporization method of nanomaterial synthesis. From the name itself, we can define the method of synthesis. That is, you're going to make the metal salt component powder to get vaporized, and again it is going to condense and deposit onto the wafer surface. Okay, in the size of nanoscale meter. Okay, so first it is a CVD, nothing but chemical vapor deposition method. So this technique involves the reactive gases. It's going to which is interact with the substrate. Substrate is nothing but your desired metal component salt. Okay, so it's used to deposit on a silicon dielectric. Major, the silica wafers are used to coat nanoparticles in all the extents of applications. Because silica is available naturally, it is having a more applications in case of electronics. So it is going to be deposited with various metal ions to get a semiconductor devices and sensors, biosensors making, and it produce a, this CVD is produce a good film quality and good coating capacity. See what are the steps is taking place in CVD. First you are going to inject your metal component ions in the form of ions, which is taken by these interactive gases into the closed vacuum chamber, and next it's going to diffuse onto the vapor surface, nothing but silica surface, and it gets absorbed on the surface and get a chemical decomposition, surface migration, site incorporation. something the wafers can incorporate some materials to get to make a bed like formats of nanomaterials, incorporated nanomaterials beds, and desorbed nanomaterials or ions get be exits through the exit nozzle. So this is happening in a case of chemical vapor deposition method, and in case of PVD, it is a physical vapor deposition used to deposit metals of high purity. Okay, you are going to place your metal in a crucible inside the vacuum chamber. It's going to be heated by the heat resistant flux, which is producing heating effect to the ions and metals all component. It's going to get vaporized and deposit on the wafer on the other side of the opposite side of this substrate materials in the form of nanoscale rings. This is happening in a PVD process. Okay, so these are the different techniques we follow to deposit the various materials onto the wafer surface. Okay, this is one of the overview. And next method is epitaxial method. From the name itself, we can define it as epitaxial. Epitaxial is nothing but a molecular arrangement or ion arrangement or electron arrangement in order manner that is happening in epitaxial method due to interaction of molecular atomic beams on a surface of heated crystalline substrate in a ultra high vacuum. You are going to deposit the materials onto the wafer surface in an ordered manner. Because of this interaction forces, it is going to be arranged in a ordered, assembled in a in an ordered manner. So the basic schematic setup of the epitaxial molecular beam epitaxial system. See, this is a cryopaneling to maintain a temperature, and it's a ultra high vacuum chamber. It's having a reed gun and reed screen, and this is all the efficient coils cells, and it's a closed setup. These efficient coils is going to produce a heat towards the substrate, and it is going to deposit again on the substrate itself, which is read by the reed, which is screened by the reed gun, and which is going to be displayed on the reed screen. That is happening in a epitaxial method. These effusion coils going to make this substrate to get vaporized, and again it's going to deposit in the form of nanoscale size. Okay, this is was read by the reed gun, and it was displayed in a reed screen. Okay, so next is the lithographic technique. Lithography is nothing but litho means is sand or stone. Graph is writing or carving. Nothing but in those days they used to make sculptures, right? Same like that, you're going to make a pattern of the desired design or desired mask or master patterns onto the any material surface or wafer surfaces for the end application. It's one of the important technique in making semiconductor devices, sensors, microchips, drug delivery microchips. Okay, so lithography is a process that uses focused radiant energy and chemical films that are affected by this energy to create a precise temporary pattern as silicon wafers or other materials. With the help of the light rays, you are going to make this master pattern, which is in a mask through the lens, which is going to be patterned over the wafer surface. Okay, so photolithography is light energy passing through a patterned mask. The light is focused onto the photosensitive surface. Chemical changes is taking place at the surface of coating and the wafers to make a pattern of this mask onto it. Okay. So there are different patterning methods are there. One is contact printing, proximity printing, projection printing, projection printing too. Okay. In case of contact printing, the mask will be placed over the wafer itself. It's going to make an exact mark of the pattern onto the wafer surface. In case of proximity, the mask is placed just distance above the wafer to make a pattern of the master. In case of projection, it is going to make a projection over the mask and to make the projected patterns on a particular point of the wafer, that is taking place a midpoint of the wafer. Your pattern is going to be made on a midpoint of the wafer. It just directly the pattern can be made with the help of this light rays. Okay, these are the lithographic pattern made a different same images. See how the lithographs is made of a constant dose of different materials, and the dose of gallium ion is used is 7.5 to the power 12. The same energy of light is given to those different materials to make a lithography. So it shows the different sizes and varies in same image. Okay. Next is the lithographic technique can also be performed with electron beam focused ion beam X-rays instead of photo rays. We can also use electron beam. Electron beam is going to be just we can't use any mask here. We can directly make a pattern over the wafer surface. It is going to be act like a drilling machine. Okay. In case of X-ray, it need of mask. It is going to exhibit X-ray onto the substrate to make a pattern of the master. Okay. In case of ion beam, the ion beam and electron beams are same thing. We can able to pattern of desired structure directly onto the wafer instead of using any pre-designed mask. That is the difference of photolithographic, electron beam, ion beam, and X-ray lithography. Okay, and let's see about the UV lithography. Apart from ion beam, focused ion beam, X-ray, photo, we can also use this UV rays also. Most probably, the technique uses only 30 nanometer of wavelength of UV. Okay, it is having a continuous of the optics. So this technique, due to of this using 4x reduction of top optics, we can able to fabricate a desired pattern of the mask on into 12 in numbers of in a same wafer. So it reduces the time of production. So the technique is used to make a pattern of a single master design onto a single wafer in a 12 numbers due to of this 4x reduction optics. So it is a less time consumption technique. Most probably prefer for various semiconductor designing and large production. Okay. Sputtering is a technique is used to sputter the target metal ions in the form of nanoscale materials onto the silicon wafer to make many semiconductor devices. Nothing but you are going to make a sputter your target atoms onto any surface. Okay, next is a micro contact printing technique. It mainly uses PDMS. PDMS is nothing but polydimethoxysiloxane. It's going to be act as a polymer, just like a stamp. It is going to act like a stamp. It's going to pattern over the silica surface. Okay, this is a silica-based elastomer. It's a mix of two compounds, like the siloxane, oligomers, and crosslinkers. Okay, so when the light rays is passed on to the PDMS, it is going to make a pattern over the silica wafers. That is the importance of this PDMS. The PDMS is used to make this micro contact printing. Micro contact printing means that even the micro size can be printed onto the wafer surface. That is the principle behind this technique. With the help of this PDMS stamp, siloxane polymer, is a stamp is coated with an ink of molecules. The ink may be any of the antibodies or biomolecules. Proteins can be used as a ink to coat over the silica wafers or any surfaces or glasses. This technique is mainly preferred to coat a biomolecules or antibodies proteins for various directions, surfaces of biosensors and sensors and microchips and detection chips. Okay, and the next is arc evaporation process. Here nothing but your substrate is going to be heat and it's going to be deposited onto the substrate surface itself. It is mainly preferred in a automotive industry to fabricate the automobile panels with the help of nanoparticles to incubate the anti-corrosion activity. Okay, so next method is the chemical method of synthesizing the nanomaterials, that is salt gel method. Salt, in case of solution, it is of solvent plus solute plus solvent. In case of solution, here it is a salt, it is going, it's a mixture of solutes in a solution, solvent, it's going to be as a salt. And gel is a gelification, that is a systematic or arrangement and a network arrangement of solutes within a system, that is called a gelification. And aging and soaking, this is going to happen in a salt gel method. Hydrolysis and condensation, reactions take place and followed by gelification, aging and drying. Drying, you will be getting aerosol or zero gel. Okay, gelification, how does it happen? A gelification, silica TiSO, tetrasilica oxide, salt is taken and mixed with water. It's going to be take a 1OH group and releases the alkyne group, that is titanium hydroxide, and you will be getting this crystal arrangement or network of gelification gel. See image of silicon oxide aerogel. And next is solvothermal reaction. Solvothermal reactions can be defined as a chemical reaction taking place between a precursor, nothing but your solute, in your solvent in a closed system at a high temperature above than the boiling temperature of the solvent and a high pressure. Solvothermal is nothing but you are going to heat the solvent, in which solvent you are going to make the nanomaterial synthesis. Okay, so above that solvent boiling temperature, you are going to heat the solution at a high pressure. This is happening in a solvothermal reaction. It involves oxidation reduction. These are the various reactions going to take place within a closed system, like oxidation reduction, hydrolysis, thermolysis, complexion, metathesis. Okay, case of hydrothermal reaction. In solvothermal reaction, you're using different solvents can be used, but it should be the boiling should be above their boiling point. So that only you will be getting a nanomaterial. But in case of hydrothermal, you have to use only the water as a solvent to synthesize the nanomaterials. That is the important thing in hydrothermal, and there is a difference between solvo and hydrothermal method of synthesis. The next is self assembly. In case of self assembly, see that it is a thermodynamic free energy. Okay, in self assembly, you have to think thought about two method of assembly, that is static assembly and one is dynamic assembly. Case of static assembly, it should be arranged on its interactive forces. Okay. Case of dynamic, static is nothing but stable in one place. So due to of interaction, it is going to be assembled in ordered manner. Case of dynamic assembly, you need to produce some external force to make the components to bind together. So what are the forces are they going to act in a self-assembly? See, covalent, ionic, van der Waals, hydrogen bond, in other forces, magnetic, electrostatic, fluidic forces are given to make the molecules to arrange in an ordered manner, and in case of polar and non-polar hydrophobicity. Okay, so this is the LB blot, laminar blot film making with the help of pressure. This is the lab scale setup for the synthesis of LB films. Okay, see, this is a solid matrix or nothing but your surface or your wafer. You're going to make a dispersed biomolecules in a solvent medium. It should be get arranged in a assembled ordered assembly onto the solid surface or wafer surface. This is how it is going to be takes place. Okay. And then says SAMs, in case of SAM, that is self-assembled monolayer, it is mainly happening with the sensor mechanism, that is fabrication of biomolecules onto the sensors. Okay. Next technique is a spray pyrolysis technique. Spray pyrolysis is the aerosol process that atomizes a solution and heats the droplets to produce the solid particles. Atomization is a production of droplets and their dispersion into the gas. Aerosol is a suspension of solid or liquid particles in a gas. This atomization, the production of droplets, is playing a major role in determining the nanoparticle size. This nozzle is going to be detect your nanoparticle size. It's going to be happening how to supply the metal salt solution through this nozzle. It is going to atomize and get deposited onto the wafer surface. Next is about this spin coating. Yes, a process in which the solution is spread evenly over a surface using centripetal force. Spin coating will result in relatively uniform thin film of a specific thickness. Spin coating is an important way to create a thin film of using in a microelectronics industry. See, you have to place your desired film component solvent into the panel which is placed on the basin. The wafer is placed and the spin coating material were placed onto the basin. So you have to load the what are the desired metal component you need to spin coat over the wafer. That's this what is going to be happen. And next it is the biological method of synthesis, that is use of plant extract mediated synthesis. So you need to prepare the extract of the plant, of any part of the plant, using different solvents, and you need to add the metal ion solution. The color change of this extract and the ion solution adding indicates this is the formation of nanoparticles, and it can be purified by centrifugation or filtration or adding or desiccation method of purification. And next is microorganism mediated synthesis. That is, there are two methods, that is extracellular and intracellular method. In extracellular, the culture were cultured for 24 hours or overnight, and the cultured solution medium was centrifuged, and the supernatant was collected, which is constituted of secondary metabolites, a waste of those cultured microorganisms, which is going to be to synthesize the nanoparticles. In case of intracellular method, you need to culture the cell with the medium constituting a metal salt solution. And after 24 hours, you need to centrifuge the culture and take the pellet and analyze the pellet for the various characterization techniques to see the nanoparticles. This is about the synthesis of nanomaterials. And thank you.